Man, turning 30 makes me feel old. I do have a foggy memory of when I started playing video games after I was born in 1992. If it wasn't for playing video games, I wouldn't have been the person that I am today, and as a content creator since 2009 for countdowns, reviews, and other types of videos thanks to Alex Roshan and of course Josh Scorcher. Now I plan to make this video to be uploaded for May 11th since as of this year's May 11th, it's my 30th birthday. But instead of making a review, I decided to make a countdown of my favorite moments throughout playing video games and everything gaming related. Such as moments during gameplay, favorite story moments, the game's theming, video game trailers, and even moments I had with my relatives and friends, whether they are moments from the past, and moments I've experienced recently. Now just because I turned 30, I still feel young. Now I'm not ranking my favorite moments based on specific order, but rather moments that are just straight up my favorites, in other words, all of them. I want to give an honorable mention of playing with other content creators, though I mostly play with Quarter Guy on games like Smash Ultimate, Monster Hunter Rise, and Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, so I do hope I will play with others in the future. Yeah, that is the only honorable mention I have. So let's celebrate my 30th birthday video on a list of my favorite gaming moments, so let's get rockin'!
It has begun!
Ever since playing Warcraft 2, Starcraft, and Diablo, Blizzard has become one of my favorite video game developers when playing PC games, and yes, even Diablo 2 and Warcraft 3. But after the Frozen Throne expansion since 2003, I waited Starcraft Ghost, but then in 2006, it was put on hold until it was cancelled in 2014. But from 2004 to 2010, I wanted to buy a Blizzard game that wasn't World of Warcraft. Yes, I skipped the MMO and the expansions Burning Crusade and Wrath of the Lich King, but I did not hate WoW, though I only did play the trial version. But then from 2007 to 2009, StarCraft 2 and Diablo 3 were announced, and then in 2010, I was back buying and playing Blizzard games, as well as 2016's Overwatch and of course the remastered StarCraft 1, Warcraft 3, and Diablo 2. I played StarCraft 2 and Diablo 3 mostly single player, while Overwatch was my go-to Blizzard modern day multiplayer. And of course, I would not ignore to buy the expansion and DLC such as StarCraft 2's Heart of the Swarm, Legacy of the Void, and Nova Covert Ops, and Diablo 3's Reaper of Souls and Rise of the Necromancer. StarCraft 2 and Diablo 3 really made me buy and play Blizzard games after being 6 years of hiatus from 2004 to 2010, and also I even brought Warcraft 3 and Diablo 2 that are bundled with the expansions, since we borrowed the games from my brother's friends, even Brood War expansion. But I placed this moment at number 10 because from 2019 to 2022, I started to worry about Blizzard since Activision's influence started to seep in, but as of right now, Blizzard and Activision has become Microsoft's family. Also, Diablo 2 as well as its remaster and 3, StarCraft 1 and also its remaster and 2, Warcraft 3 and World of Warcraft, Overwatch, Hearthstone, and Blizzard Arcade Collection are on the Battle.net app, but if you also want Warcraft 1 and 2, Diablo 1, your only choice is GOG, which is easy to get. I do hope Blizzard will have a bright future due to the buyout by Microsoft, and I hope their games will be part of Xbox Game Pass, and as of right now, Diablo 4 and Overwatch 2 are my highly anticipated Blizzard games, but I do want to check out Diablo Immortal, and I do hope Blizzard will show their unannounced survival game, and I hope they will make their own fighting game, and I'm still waiting Dreamhaven's Games, a studio made up of ex-Blizzard members. Back when I was a kid, or most of us when we were kids, we weren't that good in video games, not because of the difficulty, but unfamiliarity of the game or maybe something else. I sometimes played video games with cheats, which were my actual training wheels, or playing on the easiest difficulty before playing the games on normal mode or without cheat codes. I grew adjusted playing without cheat codes, but then there are games that are hard by design, but made as Nintendo hard or hard but fair. I was caught off guard of how games can be hard as a kid, and it can be a turnoff for some people. But during playing games on the Wii, I embraced to overcome the toughest challenges if it's beating a level or a boss. I enjoyed it in Monster Hunter, Devil May Cry, Bloodborne, Remnant from the Ashes, Ender Lilies, and most of the Mega Man games. The challenge not only comes on player skill, level design and its layout, bosses with its attack patterns, but also challenges on making a decision during the game's story, such as character choices with games like Fallout, Elder Scrolls, Prey, Deus Ex, Baldur's Gate, Icewind Dale, and other games like it which has dialogue choices. Granted, they're not really gameplay related. Now most of the games do have difficulty options, but games like Monster Hunter, Soulsborne games, and also some Souls-like games don't have it, meaning you gotta get used to it and make use of your skills. Now, Monster Hunter such as World, if I fail the quest on solo, I will retry the quest in multiplayer from random players. Now, Soulsborne games also has multiplayer, with my experience goes for the struggle against Orphan of Kos in Bloodborne, where I decided to get some backup through the Resonance Bell to defeat it. Hard games like Souls-like may not be for everyone, especially for Git Good, but I've grown to appreciate to overcome any sorts of challenges in games like a tough level or a boss that are tough as nails, like the nails from the Quake's nailgun ammo. And now, let's go for my first ever introduction to video games. Sonic 2 and Sega Genesis / Mega Drive, which all of the games and the console were my big brother's first ever video game console my family owned. It was thanks to this game and the console that I was introduced to gaming, Sonic, and also Sega, which made me a fan not just for Sonic, but Sega as a whole. I did like playing Sonic 2, but the farthest I got as a kid was between Mystic Cave and Oil Ocean Zone, though my brother and his friends managed to beat the game with or without the Chaos Emeralds. I was really drawn to its colorful graphics, memorable soundtrack, and it introduced me to Sonic's sidekick debut in this game, Tails. And besides Sonic 2, we also had Sonic 1, Sonic 3, and Knuckles, which I prefer playing Sonic 2 with Knuckles over other characters despite the lower jump height. I still remember other games we had on our Mega Drive like Jurassic Park Rampage Edition, Kid Chameleon, Toadjam and Earl and its sequel Panic at Funkatron, Alex Kidd in the Enchanted Castle, Batman Returns, Game Ground, Echo the Tides of Time, World of Illusion, a great Disney game, Pitfall the Mayan Adventure, Truxton, an underrated shoot-em-up by the way, Virtual Racing, and of course other Sonic games besides Sonic 1, 2, 3, and Knuckles, such as Sonic Spinball and Sonic 3D Blast and Dr. Robotnik Mean Bean Machine, which were the games we owned or rented or even borrowed some of the games from my brother's friends. Hell, my brother even played Streets of Rage 2 with one of his friends when he was young. And even to this day, I still buy Sega games such as the recently released Virtual Fighter 5 Ultimate Showdown and Lost Judgment with its recent DLC Kaito Files. Sonic 2 and Mega Drive are still an important part of my favorite video game moments and even my childhood, as it introduced me to gaming despite since 2017 I haven't bought anything Sonic related, even video games. Now here comes a shocker for you that Sega Saturn, PlayStation, and N64 did not introduce me to 3D games. It was via PC games thanks to games like Doom, Quake, Duke Nukem 3D, and Descent games. Some of the PC games we owned back in the day had 2D games like Worms, Commander Keen games, Jazz Jackrabbit, and Warcraft 1 and 2. Now 3D games like Doom 1 and 2 had levels 3D design, but enemies and power-ups were displayed in 2D much like Duke Nukem 3D. However, Quake and Descent 1 and 2 were the first 3D games I've played that had enemies and bosses rendered in 3D models, and the first-person shooters were the first genre that introduced me to 3D games before I played 3D games on PlayStation and N64. 3D gaming also introduced me to PC games, which is different compared to consoles as some of the PCs were bought as pre-made or with custom components to play PC games. Also, the games did not come digitally because before Steam, Epic Game Store, and GOG, the games came in CD and floppy disk, which introduced me also to disc-based games. Also, the PC games before DVD or digital copies, they came in these big boxes, and I gotta be honest, I love these boxes compared to the SNES and N64 game boxes. As for example, I have a copy of Baldur's Gate that I got from a friend, and this box contains, of course, an instruction manual which holds extra information like installing the game's user interface, and other gameplay informations like weapons, armors, other items, spells, character creation, lore of the game, and it is a huge list of information to read, but the game also comes with a map of the game, a quick reference guide which is like a mini instruction manual with things like spells, and of course a CD case that comes not one, not two, not three, not four, but 5 discs, which holy crap, this game is a huge game to install at the time of 1 to 2 gigabytes. Some of the games also came with 4 discs like Blade Runner or just a single CD-ROM to install and play the game, and I'm on a hunt for big box PC games. Back in the day, I still played PC games with mouse and keyboard, but I do play games on Steam and GOG with an Xbox 360 or Xbox One controller. I'm putting 3D gaming and PC gaming together because it both introduced me to these things at the same time when we got our first gaming computer for my dad, brother, and me to play Doom, Quake, Command & Conquer, StarCraft, Warcraft, Diablo, Worms, Duke Nukem, and even some old DOS games, and it's good that Steam and GOG offers 90s PC games that we remembered playing. When I played Project Cross Zone 2 in February of 2016, I do recall there hasn't been a new Sega game for these Sega franchises that are present in the game. No New Space Channel, Shinobi, Sakura Wars, Super Monkey Ball, Crazy Taxi, Jet Set Radio, Streets of Rage, House of the Dead, Virtua Cop, Alex Kidd, Golden Axe, Knights, and No New Virtua Fighter. But then in 2018, Sega started to bring back their old IPs with the help of developers from Sega and other developers that Sega doesn't own to revive the franchise that aren't Sonic, because some Sonic fans aren't real Sega fans. I felt really happy that Sega decided to bring back franchises via sequel, reboot, or as a remake. Some of those games received mixed reviews, and some received positive reviews. In terms of Sega franchise revivals, the highlights has to go to House of the Dead Scarlet Dawn, Space Channel 5 Kinda Funky Newsflash, which I do hope for a non-VR version, Wonder Boy The Dragon's Trap Remake, and Monster Boy and the Cursed Kingdom, Alex Kidd in the Miracle World DX, Toe Jam & Earl Back in the Groove, which Sega no longer owns the franchise, and the big ones being Streets of Rage 4 and Virtual Fighter 5 Ultimate Showdown. Now, Streets of Rage 4 became my favorite modern 2D beat-em-up game of all time, and compared to Sonic Mania, Streets of Rage 4 has sold 2.5 million copies, 1.5 million more than Sonic Mania, and also Virtual Fighter 5 Ultimate Showdown, despite being stuck with the outdated delay-based netcode, deserved the title Ultimate more than Sonic Colors Ultimate, and I am not sorry at all. It's good that some companies nowadays are bringing back their long-forgotten franchises from cryosleep, like Namco brought back Soul Calibur, Capcom with Mega Man and Devil May Cry, and I do hope they will make a new Strider game since the last game was released back in 2014, and of course Sega, which I'm looking forward to the next franchise revivals, and I gotta say this to Sega, chasing the trends like Fortnite is not the best way to bring back Crazy Taxi and Jet Set Radio. Sadness is one of the strongest themes in terms of storytelling I've ever witnessed. Even moments in RPG or action games, there are sad death scenes. Like the moments that made me sad, a death of a character that was more than a machine like Cortana in Halo 4, and Legion in Mass Effect 3, but also some endearing non-machine characters. A lot of games like Nier series, The Last of Us, Telltale The Walking Dead, Halo 4, Valiant Heart The Great War, various Final Fantasy games, The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask and Link's Awakening, This War Is Mine, Spec Ops The Line, To The Moon, Ori series, Mother 3, and other games like it are some of the most emotional games that will tug your heartstrings. But one game I recently played from 2021 was a little indie Souls-like Metroidvania game called Ender Lily's Quietus of the Nights. This game is hard, but my god, this game is sad, depressing, sorrowful, and emotional game I have ever played from the game's lore, and even its music. Also, there are gonna be spoilers. The blight coming from the Rain of Death and the Elixir really screwed up the citizens of the Land's End, where most of them were turned into mindless undead, where they have lost their sanity, where the last priestess, the protagonist Lily, who is this poor girl all along curing the Kingdom of Land's End, while she has the spirits of the dead characters aiding her in her quest, and the lore is told through the item and spirit descriptions, the diary entries, and also the flashback cutscenes of the bosses when Lily releases their souls, such as the guardians Sigrid and Selva of Sigrid to protect Lily, and Selva of being their sister. Side, Mad Knight Ulf of guarding the lily flowers, which the main character is named after, Julius, who killed his father king after learning of his father's who adopted him for obsession of immortality, Faden and his wife and their daughter of Faden trying to rid the blight, while saving his wife where he failed to do, and also even the last words of the deceased individual when the mini bosses is defeated is quite sad since they're once normal human beings, and also other bosses as well as Umbral Knight and even Lily and the clones of the priestess of Font, which the lily clones are her daughters. The game's environments throughout the game shows how much death, suffering, despair, and how sorrowful and depressing the Land's End is. The endings, which there are three, are sad, such as Ending A is where Lily leaves the Land's End behind of being freed of the Burden, but has to leave Umbral Knight behind. Ending B is where you have to defeat the Blighted Lord, the cause of the Blight at Land's End. Lily unites with Fawn to hold back the Blight of Land's End. The second part of the Blighted Lord begins, where after killing the second form of Blighted Lord, Lily purifies it to withstand the Blight, which in terms of all the Blights is gone forever. And also, Lily finally hugs Font, much like a child embracing their mother, because Lily is her own person than a clone, and this ending, I almost cried, and I did shed some tears. But Lily is still alive, free of burden, and while the people of Land's End are dead, Lily is not alone, and I feel happy she lives. But I don't want to go longer with the lore, because there are other people on YouTube who can tell more about the game's lore. I just want to move on to the music, and Ender Lilies has one of the most beautifully composed music thanks to Yamato Kasai and Cassie Wei. And most people say the music is very Nier-like, and they are right. Ender Lilies came out the same year as Nier Replicant Remake, and the piano takes the spotlight in Ender Lilies' music with surface areas like White Parish, Cliffside Hamlet, Ruined Castle, Twin Spire are somber and sad sounding music, Witch's Thicket is more whimsical, and Stalkade, Verboten Domain, and The Abyss is a tonal shift. The music on all the bosses has a leitmotif, and their boss themes are in two parts, which the second half plays when the third phase of the boss fight begins. Also, the game's art direction, the animation, as well as the attention to detail is spot on around the Ruined Kingdom of Land's End, but to conclude this, Ender Lilies is without a doubt the saddest game I've ever played in recent memory, and this game's story would make everyone cry from Hololive to grown men and women, and this game is not only a masterpiece, this game is art and one of my favorite Metroidvanias. Also, I have to say, Lily is a cute name. Creating a familiar moment from the previous game with Nuke technology to a sequel can be rather hit and miss if it's created as a flashback or a dream sequence. But if the game is a prequel to the first game and its sequels, it can be hard to create it unless it's used as a foresight to the story that follows. As long as it does not retcon the lore and story of the game, unless there's gonna be additional story detail never seen in game's original scene, but also highlight a small detail we never noticed. But in terms of iconic moment from the first game recreated to the sequel, my personal favorite has to go to StarCraft 1 9th Terra mission, New Gettysburg in StarCraft 2. Now, this was the first I've ever witnessed a video game betrayal scene by Arcturus Minx, who sent Kerrigan and most of his forces to hold off the Zerg while fighting Protoss. They repelled Tassadar's forces, but a massive amount of Zerg is ravaging New Gettysburg when Kerrigan calls Arcturus for evac, but being an a-hole, Arcturus orders the whole fleet to move away from Tarsonis, leaving Kerrigan behind, which Jim Raynor gets pissed off at Arcturus. Now, the last words Kerrigan speaking in that mission ends with an explosion, but in StarCraft 2, that ends with a Zerg screech as Kerrigan spots a swarm of Zergs approaching her, which she is hopeless killing them, as she drops her rifle and those Zergs that surround her, instead of killing her, they take her to Overmind where she becomes the Queen of Blades. The cinematic of New Gettysburg in StarCraft 2 is incredible, as Blizzard is known for since they are the gods of CG cutscenes, and I do love how Kerrigan kills three of the Zerglings, and also we see the Hydralisk bust through the wall until Kerrigan uses her last shots to kill the Hydralisk. Now, this cutscene plays in StarCraft 2 after completing the Mobius Factor mission, which is Raynor's dream. I never thought Blizzard had the balls to make a CG after my cutscene version of New Gettysburg mission from StarCraft 1 to StarCraft 2, and Kerrigan in StarCraft 2 is voiced by Battlestar Galactica actress Jerisha Helfer. They even recreated some of the scenes from Warcraft 3 to World of Warcraft, but StarCraft 2 New Gettysburg cutscene was by far the best, and I have to remind you, and I'm sorry to say this, Blizzard and Activision has become Microsoft's bitch, but in a good way. Whenever I was going to my relative or my friend's birthday parties, I was there to have fun. And of course, my cousins and friends would have PC and or a video game console, and they would have games I've never played or even owned. I did find it an enjoyable experience, especially my brother's friends would also have video game consoles. And thanks to those people, I was introduced to PlayStation and franchises like Tony Hawk Pro Skater, Mortal Kombat, Final Fantasy, Tekken, Oddworld, Crash Bandicoot, Spyro, Grand Theft Auto, Metal Gear, Bomberman, Mega Man, and N64 with franchises like Super Mario, Banjo-Kazooie, GoldenEye, Blast Corps, and Turok. My favorite franchises of those were Tony Hawk Pro Skater, Mortal Kombat, Tekken, Crash Bandicoot, Spyro, Super Mario, and Turok. But thanks to my cousins and friends, they even had NES and SNES with Super Mario Bros. 1, 2, 3, and World, Yoshi's Island, Super Mario Kart, Donkey Kong Country Trilogy, The Legend of Zelda: A Link to the Past, Super Metroid, Super Nintendo version of The Lion King, Flashback, Out of This World, Earthworm Jim, the magical quest starring Mickey Mouse, and even Pokemon through Game Boy. It was thanks to those relatives and friends that encouraged me to buy multiple consoles so I can play Nintendo games on Nintendo consoles, PlayStation games on PlayStation consoles, and Microsoft games on Microsoft consoles, though I only own Xbox 360. Also, I was introduced to imported games through one of my cousins who even owned a Sega Saturn and Dreamcast, which were the consoles I would have owned back then rather than that stupid Pokemon soundtrack CD. Also, one of my cousins also had Game Sampler 2 CD, which features demos of upcoming PC games Deathdrome, Diablo, Firefight, Monster Truck Madness, Hellbender, Warwind, Road Rash, and The Neverhood. We also even got the first Game Sampler CD that had demos of Doom, MechWarrior 2, PC version of Pitfall: The Mayan Adventures, and Fury 3. It was worth it to get introduced to PC and console games I never played, and I would play these games with them, whether it's single player or multiplayer. And my relatives and friends meant so much to me for introducing me to more games, and I would also recommend some games I play to them, especially if they're gonna be free on PlayStation Plus. Out of all my family members, the one I played the most with was my big bro, which I even did play with his friends. I also watched my brother play games I play to observe how he plays right next to him. But back in the day, we were competitive when we played video games of which has the highest skill level with games such as Worms, NHL games, Super Smash Bros., but as the years progressed, we played more cooperatively with games such as Heroes of Might and Magic games, Toe Jam & Earl, Streets of Rage, or an upcoming game that piques our both interests. Now besides me and bro, my dad played RTS games like Command & Conquer games and Blade Runner, though he wasn't much of a gamer. Usually nowadays, my brother pays a visit to me to play video games with me, or something to play on my PC while I play something on my TV, but sometimes even I pay a visit to him since he has an Xbox One X with Game Pass. But we do help each other out of buying games when we buy prepaid card for birthdays and Christmas, so we can use that card to buy a game on the digital store, whether the game or DLC, if it's on sale or not. I do not want to talk about the negative part between us since it would be a waste of freaking time to talk, but I do want to talk about me and my brother's time to play video games in front of a PC and a TV, and how much fun and we enjoyed playing video games since we had some good times. ...2018's E3 was by far the last good E3 in my humble opinion. It was dope to see that almost all press conferences ranged from decent to superb, with the exception of EA. It was also the last good E3 that featured a lot of games I was super excited for, even if there were games that I wasn't excited for but looked rather impressive. But out of all the games, there was one trailer that stole E3, and it was the fact that every single character was in Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. Oh my god, this trailer was the reason I love video games. Everyone is here, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate trailer is not only the greatest E3 trailer, but the greatest video game trailer in history. It all starts with Mario, along with three new characters, Inklings, and of course, Daisy and Ridley, that are not part of the trailer. It really was godlike that it not only brought back characters last seen in Smash Bros. Wii U and 3DS DLCs included, but also characters last seen in Melee like Young Link and Pichu, and characters last seen in Brawl like Ice Climbers, Pokemon Trainer of male and female with shiny starter Pokemons, Wolf, and of course, good old Solid Snake. Also, the trailer shows the letter E with a number for clone fighters known as Echo Fighters. Also, the orchestrated version of Lifelight is incredible. This trailer and the game is not only a giant tribute of Smash Bros., but also everything in video games in a fighting game. Smash Bros. Started with Mario and ended with Incineroar of the base roster, and the DLC of Ultimate started with Piranha Plant and ended with Sora as the last Smash Bros. Ultimate characters. Also, most of the characters in the trailer even do show their special moves and final smashes, and it's also amazing how people jump with happiness when they saw the characters that was last seen since Melee and Brawl added to Ultimate, since this was the culmination of all things Smash Bros. And also, the tagline "Everyone is here" is no joke at all. Also, Sakurai explaining the game at E3 2018 Nintendo Direct is also part of this moment. Super Smash Bros. Ultimate as a game and the Everyone is Here trailer is one of the reasons I love video games, and is one of my favorite video game moments. And remember when I said in my last Smash Bros. Related video? Well, turns out I was wrong, as this might ignite me to talk about Smash Bros. Video games are still part of my life, but who knows how long, and I gotta thank Super Smash Bros. Ultimate as well as its trailers for being part of my favorite gaming moments. I'm Tempest Worm, and if you sent me happy birthday to me, thank you. Cause it means so much to me since I'm turning 30, and I'm happy I decided to share my favorite 10 video game moments. Know the smell of the game.